So,
I'm so excited.
Miss Dakota Page, or is it Page McLean?
Yeah, so it's Dakota Page McLean now. I just got married, but my company that I have is called Next Page. It's kind of play on my name, but
I love that.
Not like Dakota Page Videography or whatever. I'm trying to like be like subtle about it, but yeah, so it's Next Page.
So thank you for coming on. I know we've been trying to make this happen for a long time, but congratulations on getting married.
Thank you so much.
And all the success you've had over the last few years, because I know it's been a while since we've talked and seen each other. So I guess let's kind of try to catch up.
I know, this is a catch up, because I don't even know when the last time we saw each other. I feel like it's been like a blur, maybe 3 years ago. So I was so excited to be on this podcast. This is so exciting.
So I guess for our listeners, could you kind of give it a little introduction of, to who you are, what you do, and kind of go take it from there?
Yeah, I am a storyteller. I fell in love with the art of videography. I kind of got into it in a really random situation. My mom's Canadian and my dad's from Holland. And so we just have family all over the world. And the way I could like connect with my family is like sending little slideshows, and my uncles would be in BC and they would like send me little videos and stuff. And I felt like I was a part of every trip and everything that they were in, even though I was miles away. And so I just absolutely fell in love, like as a little kid, just like being a part of my whole family's lives, whether I saw them or not. And so I started picking up an iPod Touch and I just started recording on like the iMovie and just the little soundtrack that iMovie plays and stuff. Yeah, and I threw it on Instagram just for myself. And then some friend, like a follower of mine, asked if I could do their wedding video. And I was like, wait, what? And I was, I think, 15 years old. And I literally got dropped off by my parents. And I shot the wedding video. I learned on a DSLR how to, like, work it. And I still used iMovie. But I absolutely fell in love with videography and capturing the human things, the messy things, the beautiful things, the like, literally, just, like, indulged. I fell in love with videography and creating that art form. So what is it? 5 years later, I still do it. I absolutely love it. I feel like my heart and my passion has grown even more and more. And yeah, so I'm doing filmmaking full-time still. And I do a lot of wedding elopements, and I call it intimate weddings of like a guest under 50, like probably. But yeah, I've been busy, I've been traveling, and it's still just capturing a lot.
Yeah, that's pretty interesting too, because I feel like this might be a little bit more of a unique episode, because not only because you're the first lady that we have on, but also a lot of people, everybody's kind of been from different areas of like the filmmaking world, but you know, you like specialize in, you know, wedding videography and storytelling. And not only that, because like I know a lot of people have shot weddings, but you know, like you said, they're more intimate, a lot of them like elopement destination type weddings. So talk a little bit about that, like how did that come about, from, you know, you first shooting this first wedding that you did and edited in an iMovie, and kind of what it's like, where you've been able to build it to what it is today.
Yeah, I'm extremely fortunate. It's kind of funny because my husband and people around, they are like, I feel like a lot of filmmakers, they start in like the wedding industry and then they kind of move up into like movie productions, or there's a whole commercial, you know, exactly. Same, which, yeah. I love. Yeah, seriously. And I think it's like a really good step as far as like being a wedding videographer and then kind of like moving down the road. But for me, I've just absolutely love the position that I'm in, that I do a lot of brand videos on the side. I do just like talking about how the brand has become and their message, because I believe every brand has a message and a narrative behind. So I like to do that as well. But I've just found my niche in just creating like a story, because I feel like every couple, whether they found each other is like a unique way, or they've gone through stuff like the pandemic and they've just gone through it, you know, and like I have just fallen in love with just love, I guess. And I'm such a hopeless romantic. And so my husband literally is like, are you gonna like move on? And I'm like, nope, I am so excited about it. And recently I just got married and I went to Mexico. I can't do Ohio, Ohio winter. And so, yeah, seriously, right? It's like freezing outside. No, but so last November I went, and pretty much I fell in love with like the elopement style, because I've been shooting weddings for 5 years. And when there was like a lot of guests, like 500. Oh, sorry.
Bringing the mic a little bit closer. Yeah.
Is that better?
Oh, yes.
Oh, look at that. That's good. Sorry. I just have fallen in love with the elopements because it's a little bit more intimate, mm-hmm. and it's about the couple. Growing up in Ohio, and this is something I'm very proud of, I didn't have a lot of mountain ranges or ocean sides and coasts and stuff like that. And my Instagram feed is just completely like Utah, Montana, California. Mm-hmm. And I obviously want to shoot there, but I didn't have that situation. I was still in high school. I was shooting films, still making it my full-time career. And I kind of found a niche that I want to capture the human, the emotion of the couple. And then everything else is going to be a bonus. So like if we are in Ohio with cornfields, the people are going to feel from my films based off of the couple. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like I focus so much on the niche and the raw, and like I don't want to be the perfectionist actually when it comes to shooting. I want to just capture it every part of the day. And so from that, for 5 years, I kind of started making different, like a portfolio based off of like, sorry. I feel nervous right now. I talk on my Instagram all the time and like I'm by myself, but no, I get passionate. So I'm trying not to like stray away.
No, feel free to
scattered. I'm like a little scatterbrain, a little squirrel or whatever. I feel like.
No, no worries.
No, but, sorry, what I was going back to,
you were starting to talk about like what, you know, the reason, you know, with these couples, you know, even if it's just in Ohio, yeah. that yeah. you still focus on
location,
telling their story.
Yeah. Location based has never been like a priority for me in a way, if that makes sense. Like I want to book clients that are absolutely madly in love and they want to just indulge with themselves, like literally just like absolutely fall in love again on their wedding day. And so, yeah, sorry.
No, I was going to ask, what is that process like as far as like, you know, you selecting a couple that you're going to film?
Yeah.
Because I would imagine that you just don't, you know, anybody that hits you up, you don't really necessarily just,
yeah.
okay, I'm going to shoot your wedding.
Yeah, I'm super thankful that I've kind of transitioned my business as far as like I'm booking my clients based off of like I'm deciding who I want, because I have had like a storytelling niche and I'm super, super proud of how Next Page has created that like narrative and that brand that I want. So when people book me, they know that it's going to be very authentic. It's going to be very raw, but it's going to be their story. I have so many people who don't even know this couple that I've like shot, and they have like they're crying because they have like emotional connection. And that is honestly one of the best compliments ever, because I want to capture their story. I believe everybody has a story, whether it's a brand, whether it's a couple, everyone's got something to say. And I get to be that like a little bit messenger to like create that message through an art form. And so elopement has just like shooting elopements and intimate weddings have just become like 10 times fold better as far as like storytelling, because it's definitely more intimate. It's focusing on the couple, especially when it's including like their activities that they like to do, like places that they love. I just travel with them, and I kind of am like their third wheel in a way, which is so funny, and I love it because I love spoiling my couples. I seriously love being a part and serving them. But it's so cool because I just have fallen in love with everybody's unique story, and that is my main goal. I never want a video to look like one I've done before. And that really challenges me as a filmmaker, because I feel like the wedding industry can be kind of repetitive. It's like getting ready, the ceremony, bridal portrait shots, and reception. And I that's kind of how like a wedding goes down. So I feel like it can kind of get repetitive. But that's as far as Next Page, we take it one step a level up, and we really try to create like a unique, emotional, touching film that like really just captures the couple fully. So I absolutely love doing what I do, and elopements has been, just a whole level up for me as far as capturing it.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting because I've, you know, done my fair share of weddings, and like very early on I did weddings too, and it, I don't want to say, I guess I kind of was turned off by weddings in a sense that not that I didn't enjoy the couples that I shot and telling those stories, because I feel for me, as a creative filmmaker, like I just want to, yeah, like same as you, just want to be able to tell a story, whatever it is, mm-hmm. right? And like I feel weddings do play, you know, there is a uniqueness to them because they, you know, you are capturing a special moment that means a lot to a lot of people, mm-hmm. and something that's, you know, gonna live on forever. Like I've had couples, you know, hit me up a couple years after the yeah. fact, and like, you know, we still look at this wedding video.
It's powerful. You know. Oh, it's one of the, I honestly think, like, as a, like a bride herself, like, I believe videography is the main thing that you should be, like, putting your money budget into. Like, I believe if you want your dream venue, go get it. If you want your dream dress, go get it. But, like, all of that stuff is going to, like, just be a moment's worth. You know what I mean? But, like, your video is forever. Like, I call it a forever film. And that sounds cheesy, but it is, though.
It's
for generations to come. Like, how cool would it be to, like, see your loved, like, your parents or your grandparents' wedding video? That is wild. Like, this is a huge, huge, like, direction of your entire life, and to capture it is a must. And for me, I talk about it all the time. I'm very, like, authentic about it because most of my brides are first-time brides. You know, we don't know what we're doing in a way, and so I always talk about, like, the flowers, they will wilt, the party favors will be thrown away, the dress you wear for one day, but the only thing that you can take on and hold on to is your wedding film. Actually, for the most part, I believe in wedding photos as well. They're beautiful, it's a fun Instagram post, but, like, the movement of your dress, your grandma crying, your
it's just something different about yeah. that emotion that you feel from watching
it's motion, it's emotion, it's depth, it's and I love, like, using audio as well. It's so important as far as, like, figuring out that direction of, like, setting the scene with, like, the music behind it, and you're adding your vows. It's so, so powerful. I love adding, like, vows to the film. It's just such a raw, intimate, like, touch for all the film. So it's just an absolute, like, playground, actually, for me to, like, really create. It doesn't feel repetitive anymore, because it's a lot of couple, like, I book couples who want to do the non-traditional weddings now. They want to focus on two becoming one, and they want to do it based off of, like, what they want to do, and not so much the wedding industry, not so much the cliche.
Yeah, the cookie cutter standard.
Yeah. They take their day and they're like, okay, we like to go hiking, so we're gonna include that, or we want to have a motorcycle entrance. Do you know what I mean? Like, they incorporate what they like in their as a couple. Do you know what I mean? And they throw it into their day, and that makes their wedding video that much more intentional. But I believe it is such a necessity for everybody, because there are moments that just kind of, they're fleeting in a way, and mm-hmm. your wedding day, it goes fast, and just like holding on to those films is priceless. Actually, they say a picture is 1,000 words, video is priceless. It really is, because yeah, you can just get that emotion and you hold on to it, and it's powerful stuff.
What are some of the things, you know, you said, you know, one of the things that I struggled with, like, filming weddings is, you know, I guess I was trying to make that point earlier, was that not so much like, I didn't have a problem with the couples or telling a story, you know, just capturing their day, but yeah, it's I guess I didn't really try to make it I tried to make it more as exciting as I could, yeah. you know, in filming, but, you know, you mentioned that, you know, you kind of figured out a way to, like, not make it as repetitive, and, you know, what are some of the things that kind of led you to deciding, you know, I guess what I would like to know is, like, how involved are you with the planning now, right? Because I would imagine a lot of times, you know, when people are coming to hire you, they're already planning a destination wedding,
yeah.
right? Or something, an elopement of that type. And then, you know, how involved are you once they reach out? Like, what is that like?
Yeah, I actually really, I've recently been booking less weddings, and I've been focusing on just a smaller number of couples, because I am part of, like, the wedding process in a way, like the planning, especially with elopements, like, because I want to find locations that they want to shoot that is very cinematic for us, that is, like, epic. And so I do a lot of background helping and planning with my brides, and I love it. But yeah, and then I honestly, like, different throughout, like, the planning process, I have them make, like, a Spotify, like, playlist that they kind of see their day. Whether, let's say they're in Colorado and it's a little bit more folk, you know what I mean? A little bit more, like, hiking, a little bit more, like, nature pulled and stuff. Like, I will have them create like a playlist of kind of what they think their day is, the vibe and stuff. And then I get to see that and I get to feel that like energy of the music. And then I kind of get to set the tone of how maybe the video wants to be. And I always ask them, what do you want the video to feel? Do you want it to feel romantic? Do you want it to feel energy, like the epic energy, like fast, like run with me? Do you want it to feel very intimate, like raw, like really just honed into the couple? Or do you want it like about your whole family too, you know? So I am all about like kind of prepping before I'm at the shoot. So I have already like a music suggestion, like a genre, a feeling. I help them with their vows sometimes, like literally, wow. Like just because it's such a bulletproof part of the video. Do you know what I mean? That really, really strong.
Yeah, it's like the verbiage. Meat and potatoes.
It is, seriously though. And so I'm like, I want to make that as strong as possible as well, you know? So it's a lot of like back and forth, which I love, because if that back and forth, that like relationship, because I believe Next Page is completely relationship built, because down the road when it's your wedding day, we have set such pillars for your wedding video. There's so much stuff that's behind the scenes that's kind of been creating this video before it even was even like press record type of thing. So I love that. And then it gets really fun because then I'm like mashing it all together and I'm like creating this masterpiece that like not only I like did, but they did without even realizing, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, because they were involved every step of the way, literally.
This is their wedding, you know? Yeah. And it's so cool because they orchestrated something that is meaningful to them. And I get to just like, I'm the fortunate one to get to like bring it to life. So I'm part of the process, and that's why I've just kind of like taken a little bit less bookings, because I want to make every video as intentional, as meaningful, as purposeful as possible.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense, because that allows you to, you know, the service that you're providing, it's more than just making a video. You like you said, you're very involved from the beginning to be able to create, you know, be able to capture the moment the best as you guys can. So I think that's awesome. And what has that been, you know, like for kind of not only with, you know, you're involved with the process, what was that like with your wedding?
Yeah, it's super funny because your wedding videographer and your photographer, they actually kind of become your wedding like planner in a way, you know what I mean? Or your like day of wedding planner, because you're on their schedule the whole time. You know what I mean? Like they're like, oh, it's sunset at like golden hour. We're going, and you're just following them. And so, I believe in during like my process, like I had a wedding day planner, but I knew my vendors, my crew was pretty much going to be calling the shots as far as where we're going and stuff. But one of the biggest things that I stressed before I was like married, and also it made it like so crystal clear and like confirmed it for me while I was like a bride, was that vendors, who you're booking, is extremely important on your wedding day. And I knew that before, you know what I mean? Because I've been with the brides before for 3 years, you know what I mean? 4 years prior, like, of just, I'm with them their entire wedding day. But when I got married, I didn't, like sometimes I wasn't even with, like, my girlfriends anymore. I was just with my videographer and my photographer. And so having that relationship beforehand, and, like, they were kind of the same way. I booked people that were kind of like me in a way, they were very relationship based. They knew exactly what I wanted. So when I was with them on day of, it wasn't me explaining them. It was or like explaining to them. It wasn't me reiterating. It wasn't me like breaking down my vision. That was already like established. Planned. That was established. Yeah. So when I was on my wedding day, I could just look at my husband and just like get lost.
Enjoy,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Enjoy the day. And I knew that they got it taken care of. And so that's what I want to do. I want every bride to feel that like that relaxedness, and they also know that their like content and magic is making, and they don't really need to like stress over it, because in this day and age we all want to have that really nice like photo to post about Mr. and Mrs. Do you know what I mean and stuff. And so it's a goal for me to make them feel as relaxed as possible, because your wedding day should be enjoyed.
Right.
Yes. And I've had some brides that are literally like, I've had more fun at like somebody else's wedding, and that just breaks my heart. That breaks my heart, because it's supposed to be your day, you know? And like, so I've heard so many like traumas in like of brides before, and they just like, they didn't have that preparation almost. And so that is relationship based, and serving my brides is number one. And obviously creating comes through all of that serving and that relationship building. But yeah, it's extremely important as far as like finding your vendors and connecting with them, and yeah, having that like clear vision that you guys are both on the same page.
Yeah. What, you know, hearing you talk about like how, you know, your process and how you approach that, reminds me of, you know, Josh Emmerich, another, you know, guest. I name drop him all the time here on the podcast, but very good friend of mine, and he, you know, he used to film weddings as well, and some of the best weddings that I was a part of, some of the best weddings that I've been involved with have been weddings that he shot. And literally, I mean, not only with what he was doing with the wedding side of video, but also, I mean, he does that with every client that he takes on, but it's all very, you know, relationship focused. So like even before, like we're talking, you know, they're talking about like what the creative is going to be, what it's going to look like. A lot of it is just talking, getting to know each other and just kind of understanding, you know, where they're at, yeah. and really, you know, making sure that it's a good fit. Like, that's kind of what I'm hearing from you.
Yeah.
And like it's, and I feel that once I kind of understood that, because before I did that, I would get calls sometimes, be like, hey, you know, somebody canceled, my videographer canceled on Friday. Yeah. And it's like, you know,
it's more of a transaction and yeah. not like a relationship based. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? It's like you come in, which I believe, like you come in, you do your job and you leave. I understand that. But like for me, weddings are so emotional already.
Yeah, it kind of has to be
so important. Like, yeah, like you're planning it for, some people plan it for 3 years, like, you know, like, and it's all on 12 hours of a day. Like it's, I feel like it should be more than a transaction.
Yeah. And like, I feel like those, and I think that's, I've had, I don't know, I guess that's what has left the sour taste in my mouth is because of that. Yeah, because I wasn't really involved with, you know, the few weddings that I have done like that, where I'm not involved with that whole process of getting to know the couple, understanding what their expectations are, what they want to do, or even, you know, being able to, just from knowing them, you're able to, you know, when you're putting together the story, like you're able to kind of, you know, find direction and be able to, okay, this is what they like. This is how this couple is.
Yeah, you add personality to it. Yeah, I think that's what I love. Like, and I always wanted to be like a wedding planner growing up, which is kind of funny. I do trips all the time. I actually have my Dutch passport, so I'm like a dual citizen. So I just try to travel as much as possible. And that being said, the elopements and kind of wanting to plan weddings is kind of like a really nice niche that I'm kind of in. Because when my brides are like, I've never actually been to wherever, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They're like a dream location, Arizona or whatever. I'm like, oh, guess what? I've been there. I can help you out. Yeah, like this is like what I would do. Do you know what I mean? Like I can really like start like directing them and helping them. And it's like more of like kind of, yeah, relationship based. And then I can throw in personality into their video. It's not just a cold cut like film anymore, you know, and adding vows, adding like different medias, the sound behind the scenes, like all of it. It's just like create, it's a masterpiece because yeah, it's so exciting for me.
Yeah, I'm sure that's allowed you to like really involve your business because it's, you know, like the value that you're providing is not just, yeah, it's not, you're not just creating a video.
Yeah.
You're involved with helping them choose locations and really, you know, plan this out to be, you know, this grand thing, because I love your videos. Like they're, you know, they're awesome. And like it's funny because, right, you know, people have seen a million, you know, wedding films, and like honestly, like some of my favorite wedding films have been yours, that like the ones that you make, and
I'm blushing,
and Josh's too, you know, like my friend Josh, he's you know, when he was doing them, a lot of it is just really getting to know the couple, so he would interview them. And what's awesome is that, you know, he's, when it comes to like the wedding day, you know, they've had this relationship already.
Yeah.
For, you know, however many months of just getting to know them, that, you know, you're able to recall, you know, things. So when he's interviewing them, it's like very like documentary based. They were like very documentary type films where, you know, they're like interviewing them, but like you're recalling things and conversations that you've had. And it just really drove, you know, like the story.
Yeah.
So like whenever the
adds depth to it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because like you see the bride and she's just in like this beautiful gown, but you just don't know much about her. And like I love that, like the interviewing, because then you get depth as a viewer. You might not even know her,
oh,
but
like
then you
this
kind of
necklace my great grandmother,
yeah,
gave it
that
to
is
me,
so cool.
Or
see?
You know, things like,
yeah,
that. And
that's awesome.
You know, it's there was one where they were you know, they'll talk about like things from their first date, or, you know, comparing like the first look to, you know, when they first went out on a date or when they moved in together, just,
yeah,
random things like that just really drove the emotion like on the film. And
yeah,
like that's one of the things that like I enjoy watching the wedding films for that reason, just because of like the feelings that they convey.
Yeah. You get something out of it, which is so cool. Like literally my dad, he'll like watch my videos and he doesn't know my brides and he's just like crying. I'm like, you little sucker for love. But I love it though, because he has like a bond with my couples. Do you know what I mean? Because like, yeah, like you said, you can like break down little things that are they're including in their day that if you just don't like break it down, you just don't see it. You just don't know it. And so I love that. I need to meet up with Josh. Josh, that's so awesome.
Yeah, and like, and it's cool seeing how he was able to transition that into, you know, like the storytelling that he does now. So I know you're, you know, the wedding side of things are kind of like your bread and butter. But like, I know that you also, you know, do like social media content. You work with brands. You're kind of influencer yourself.
I love to have my foot in every door. Yeah, I love it.
So how's that? How has all of that been able to? Well, I guess we can go a couple of ways with it. But you know, how have you been able to kind of, you know, balance all of that, right? With, you know, between planning trips to Arizona or Mexico or wherever, but also, you know, it's like totally different, you know, industry. And like, how have you been able to kind of transition into, how did you transition into that? And how much of a role does it play in, you know, your brand overall, right?
Yeah, that's the real question, is like, how do you balance it all? I know every creative, they just try to, they're hungry. I feel like every creative I meet, they're really actually hungry for like so much. And that's how I feel as well. Like Next Page is my baby. And I don't like to like make it like a narrow saying that I do wedding videography, because I do brand. Like I said, I do a lot of brand promos. I've done real estate videos. I've done commercials. I've done recruitment videos. I've done like all of the boring stuff, the exciting stuff. I've done travel videos, festival videos. I do a lot of brand collabs right now as well. I'm just kind of building up my own personal content, because I even walked in here and I'm just like recording constantly. It's actually something I love to do, which is so cool, having your passion as something that you do for a full time. But as far as like wedding videography, sometimes they're not the gigs I really, really want. But like you said, they're the bread and butter. It's just stuff that you kind of have to get out the door. And so for me, I still wanted that creative kind of, I'm making that like storytelling, you know what I mean? I'm making that narrative. I'm making that that emotion, that story or whatever, because I'm capturing other people's story. And sometimes I'm like, oh yeah, I have something to say as well. So this is like my form of just kind of like creating my own, like I want to keep on creating, and I don't want to get burned out by just like paid work. I know that sounds weird, but I want to.
I totally understand, because I mean, even one of the reasons why we're here having this conversation is because of that, because it's, you know, for me, this is an outlet to do different types of creation, because kind of get caught up in the day to day and, you know, doing interviews or, you know, whatever the, you know, the paid work is.
It's something like, to fuel you creatively. Yeah. And so like for traveling, that is something that fuels me on, like, I've never been more inspired than like by a new location or the sound of the ocean or literally just like a silent like mountain range. Like that stuff sparks so much joy for me. And like I said, I cannot not record. It's hysterical.
Right.
My friends are like, Dakota, just enjoy the moment, which I believe in, but I'm also like, okay, just one second. but seriously. And so I'm creating constantly. So I love doing travel films. I love also creating relationships wherever I go with fellow creatives and also brands, because brands are, I just think, are so powerful, and to work with them and ones that I really believe in and I know, and like getting to do a lot of promo stuff with them. So I do like my foot kind of in everything as far as like brands, traveling, and to balance it, I'm still figuring it out. I think that is kind of
I feel like everybody's kind of, yes. You know, you're always kind of like, I had this saying in my head, but like you're pretty much, you know,
you're working 24/7.
Yeah. You're just figuring it out as you go.
Yeah. You really are. And I really haven't figured it out, but I do believe like just with the pandemic and last year and all the craziness, like I feel like, because I got so many, postponed weddings and stuff, I just was completely overworked, and I'm 22 years old. And I was already getting burned out, which that's not, that's a red flag kind of. And so I kind of had to reevaluate, and I was like, okay, wait, let me see what actually drives me, what actually is like fueling me, what's positive in my life. And that's going to be my priority, because if I'm spending my time, my energy, my money on stuff that's not fueling me, that's not going to, like, I'm not going forward in a way. So I kind of had to do a real evaluation. And that's why I decided like a little bit less bookings of weddings. So then I can do stuff that like fuels my drive, because last year I did nothing really creatively just for Dakota Page. You know what I mean? It was just like, for a lot of paid gigs. Again, I'm not complaining, because I love what I do, but I think, having my foot in different outlets now, to create, like filmmaking, is something that fuels me. And it's not, and it first off, it builds my portfolio. It builds like my knowledge. It like challenges me as a creative. And yeah, it just, I get excited, man. Like I literally will hear a song these days and I'm like, I'm storyboarding already, you know? And now I get to like make that happen. When last year I was just getting really just burned out. And so that's become a priority, is like, I want to travel. I want to work with brands that I believe in and not really like, oh, I'm going to do this just because they'll send me free content or they'll pay for a media kit or whatever. Now I'm like, oh wait, it's more of like, I'm doing it because I want to, and like a little bit of a selfish route. And I think every creative needs to kind of figure that out, because I feel like we throw ourselves in there and we kind of get burned out, at least for me. I just tried booking every gig and I tried doing everything, but.
Yeah, I feel like that's a trap that a lot of people get, they kind of fall into early on. I mean, I'm guilty of that as well, where sometimes, yeah, you feel like you kind of have to, you know,
get the ball rolling. Yeah, whatever.
Keep going nonstop. And really, I feel like that's kind of right where a lot of times where people end up leveling up is, because once they reach that point, that boiling point, right, where they're kind of like, yeah, this is, you know, I'm overworked. I'm not being fulfilled with what I'm doing, or, you know, this isn't as fun anymore. And I want to get involved with other things. And like, I feel that that's kind of what. Yeah, I mean, that's a lot of times that's what ends up driving people to like change it up and to get into different things. You know, like for me, I've literally bounced around from, you know, doing all different types of videos. And even to this day, I'm still kind of like figuring out what is the thing that I enjoy doing the most. But it really boils down to, for me, I guess right now, my thing is just being able to have a good experience on set and learning different areas of like filmmaking where, you know, my lighting may not be as strong, but being able to learn to like be a better like DP or working with, you know, like bigger crews. A lot of like the work that I'm doing now more recently has been, you know,
is it making you happy? Are you feeling good?
I think it has. Like, and one of the biggest, I feel like one of the biggest drivers for me has been that a lot of the work that I have been doing has been with friends. And a lot of people that, you know, we most of the time are on the same crew, and it's doesn't feel like work as much. Like I just put something on Instagram the other day where, you know, it's like, oh, it doesn't, you know, how is it really work when you're like hanging out with your friends? Because literally that's what it feels like. We're just like shooting that's the so shit, cool. You know, I just hanging that. Out yeah. And, you know, we're obviously making, creating things and, you know, making films and whatnot, but it's not. Yeah, it doesn't feel like work in that sense. And of course, it has its fair share of challenges, right? But, you know, just being able to have different outlets to express yourself, whether it be, you know, with podcasts or just creating different things, like it's very important. So with that said, what? I wonder what that is.
Someone is moving around.
You know, like for context, you know, we're kind of still building out the studio here, and, you know, there's people coming in and out and furnaces come turning on and off, but
it's a pretty cool space though. It's like a creative playground. I love the energy.
I'm really looking forward to like once we have it like all fleshed out, that it'll, you know, it'll feel more of it'll feel more like home, where like I right now it's nice having a space that you could kind of go to and film, because early on we were like, for me, I was either going to like somebody's location or at their studio for some time. I was like, I would rent out a space and it just wasn't home here. I have, you know, this is kind of like already set up and just come sit down and talk. But I think, you know,
it's so funny when you wear your headphones, you can catch everything. It's everything, incredible. Right? Yeah. I'm like, oh, what's happening? I love it.
It's something I'd like to touch on from, you know, and like, it's kind of been a theme like in the last few episodes has been outside of like the creative work, you know, what are different things that you have that you do to kind of, you know, you mentioned, you talked a little bit about it, how, you know, being able to do different types of creative, you know, especially like whether it's for like with different brands or for your own personal brand, how do you kind of step back and kind of, you know, I guess find yourself whenever you're not feeling all the way there, or, you know, you're struggling through an edit, or, you know, had a bad experience with a wedding or a client or what, you know, whatever that may be, you know, what are some of the things that like drive you to, or motivate you to kind of get back on the horse or sort
It's difficult because I kind of mentioned it before, but I love what I do. I love it. But it kind of gets almost a little bit lonely because I will be on shoot with my bride and groom and it'll be epic. I'll be there for like 9+ hours or whatever. And then I'm editing for 25 hours, you know? And so I feel like as a creative, you can't really plan how your week will go in a way because like your creative drive goes so like a roller coaster. Like yeah, I will always, you know, seriously, like I feel like I'm more creative in the morning, but recently it'll be like 11 o'clock and I will pull out my laptop and I'll start editing. And I almost have to just like go with what I'm feeling in a way. And that's kind of hard to make a routine, but I believe routine for me in my moment of life is just like necessity. And creating into that routine is like reading a book. And I'm not even a big reader, but I'm a huge advocate of Jay Shetty, Think Like a Monk. I don't know if you've read it before. Yeah. It is phenomenal. I love it. So like regrouping on that, I love painting. You know what I mean? And almost like leaving your like filmmaking world and going into something else, tapping into something else to like almost break free. Because if you're looking at a film for not like 6 hours, let's say, and you walk away, I feel like you're going to have a better eye coming back into it. You know, you have to kind of take a step back. And for me, like walking, like listening to a podcast, like sketching, literally I have to almost like do something else. Also, I think it is my biggest spark, I feel like, is actually being with another creative and kind of like this. I always feel motivated. I always feel energized. I always get something out of it. And then I'm like, okay, I needed that. I needed a fuel. I needed like human connection. And then I can go back and kind of like throw myself into it again. So for me, it's something I'm constantly figuring out. And that's one thing about Next Page is like, I never want to say I have it figured out. That is something I'm huge about. I want to be very authentic with every bride, with every client that I'm in, because that's I feel like the human thing of me is like, I don't want to have I don't have the answers. And that's something I'm like, that's something I will take on. But Next Page is kind of like the next thing. Like, I don't know what Next Page will become in 10 years. Do you know what I mean? Maybe we'll just do completely commercial, but maybe we'll just do merch. Like, who knows? Do you know what I mean? Like, and yeah. I think that's when I created the brand, is that I knew that I'm very like emotion based and my emotions can fluctuate, my motivation can fluctuate, my desires and passions can fluctuate. So Next Page is kind of like a little bit of a brand of me, of kind of like, you just have to figure out what you want to do and do it right, master it, and then just know that it might change. Do you know what I mean? Like, for me at least, I'm very passionate about what I do, but not always I wake up and I feel creative. Yeah, and I feel like some creatives can relate to that. Like,
Totally. Like I, you know, and you said it like perfectly that it's like, yeah, you know, of course you have this, you know, this amazing thing that you do. You said that you enjoy doing what you do and you don't have any complaints about it, but like, yeah, you're never always 100%, right? You're not always, your energy is not always there. So I think it's important, right, to be able to be self-aware in that sense that like, yeah, okay, I'm not feeling it. And you're able to identify that and step away and kind of express yourself in different ways so you can bounce back to it and kind of get, you know, get back into it.
What are your ways, may I ask? Like kind of like how you kind of bounce back, like if you're so, kind of feeling a little bit like,
I start a podcast.
Oh, look at you. Wow. I didn't even know that. I'm kidding.
So, like for me, it's really, I feel like, you know, like I've talked about it before. I've been kind of figuring it out for like the last 2 years where it's just really been just trying different things. And
do you think you'll ever figure it out?
No. And like,
that's
kind of where I was going to go with it. That like, I feel like, a lot of creatives, we're always kind of like need to scratch that itch. Like, I don't want to say it's like an addict, but I guess almost we are. Cause like, for me, I've had some like very successful shoots in a sense that I feel like, yeah, of course, like every shoot, like I try to do my best and, you know, everything, but there have been a couple experiences that I've had that have left me feeling like when you walk away from that shoot or turning in an edit and like you're like very, you feel very, you know, you kind of have like this you get this like dopamine hit of like, yeah, like, yeah, I did that.
Yeah.
And for me has been kind of just chasing that, those few experiences that I've had. And I've, when I don't feel like that, it's been pretty challenging and like, just like, I feel like crap or I struggle getting through edits or I'm not as motivated, you know, when I show up to a shoot and like I've had to, you know, having, you know, one of the reasons why I started a podcast was to have conversations with other people, not only to like connect, but also just try to hear what everybody else does, just because, and then see how I can apply that into my life. Right.
Yeah, I love that.
So it's been a little bit of that. And, you know, like I started mountain biking about 2 years ago. So like that's been fun. So like just, you know, it's a similar way to you, just kind of being able to decompress with things that are not necessarily, you know, that creative work or that type of work. You know, sometimes if I feel like I'm being involved too much with like commercial work, then, you know, maybe shooting a music video or doing something else that just kind of changes it up.
Yeah, for sure. Because I sense myself already, like, I did a lot of, like, wedding videography, and now I'm like, oh, wait, I have, like, a hunger for something else. And that's when I feel it, I need to, like, jump on it. And I think that's, creatives are so interesting. First off, we always are hungry for more, and we always, it's kind of like an addict, which is interesting. We just, we're never satisfied almost,
though.
Yeah, that's
the word.
We're never satisfied. And, like, I believe, like, I will bust out an edit. I'm, like, so proud of it. I'm like, okay, what's the next thing? You know what I mean? I'm like, okay, we gotta find it again. But, yeah, I believe in... just kind of like figuring, like, what am I going to say? Yeah. Like exposing yourself to different, even like forms, like challenging yourself, like, yeah, music video or something like that. Then it just starts sparking something else. But as a creative, just being hungry, we sometimes almost feel like we're a step back in a way, because something that I'm kind of struggling with is like, and this is kind of like a different direction. But like for me, sometimes you do feel alone as creative. You're like putting in all the hours, and I go on Instagram and then I start seeing people who I look up to, but it's almost like a comparison. And then I go back to my edit and I'm like, oh, I feel like I gotta restart over. But you know, then that's not the case at all, because there's actually no comparing when it comes to creatives. Like, because it's everything is different. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. It's like an entirely different concept. Even if it's a wedding video, the whole story is different, and there's no comparing that's needed. And I feel like in the world, there's just so much content out there, and it's almost like, all right, you just gotta focus and give it your all. And that's all you can do these days. Do you know what I mean? Just give it your all. But I feel like for me, that's something I generally have to work with, because there's like videographers out there that I want to like become in a way. You know, I have a version of myself that I haven't hit yet, and I feel like I'll never hit that, because a creative, we're always hungry. Like, you know, like how you're like, how do you balance it? I'm like, I'm figuring it out, and I betcha I will always be trying to balance it forever, you know, and always reevaluating and like trying to figure out what is best for my life right now, and where my brand wants to go or needs to go and stuff. So it's such an exciting world, but I feel like it can be a lot, because there are so many different routes. There's never like a right way to make a wedding video. And there's always so many opinions and different outlets to like create it. And for me, I've always just have to like, okay, this is my computer. I just need to like look at it. You know what I mean? And like sometimes putting away your phone is like the best thing you got to do. You know, I believe in like creating your Instagram feed and making it a scrapbook and throwing your entire portfolio onto it. But just being in that niche of like, I'm creating and I'm bettering myself, and my brand will show that down the road. And just... yeah, kind of like redirecting in a way, like your company always, yeah.
And with all of that, like, how do you find, like, I know you, like, pump out a lot of content, not only, you know, your personal brand, wedding films, you know, I've seen some, like, branded content. And, like, how do you even fit that in with everything else that you're going, as far as, you know, just, like, creating, like, all these, you know, different pieces and content that you have to do, just to kind of, I feel like not a lot of it is just kind of get putting yourself out there and, you know, creating these different pieces. But how do you balance that with, you know, everything that's going on in your life?
Yeah, that's something I've definitely like just tried to figure, like try to really analyze, because I do have a lot on my plate. I feel like I look at my planner, I'm like, okay, so yeah, I got like 5 hours of shooting, and then like 40 hours of like, and that's just like brand stuff. Do you know what I mean? Let alone like the stuff that I'm actually working on, like getting with paid
clients.
So
are you like, is your day like, you know, do you kind of like structure your day? Like specifically, you're like, okay, I'm going to allot this,
yes,
you know, these times for social media. Yeah. This is, I'm going to be editing.
Yeah. To make that simple. Yeah. I do structure my day, as far as like, I wake up and I feel like if I'm having a coffee in my hand, I can bust out emails and my inquiries right away. I can bust, like get those quick. And then, I kind of, based off how I'm feeling or what my edits, I will do like next page edits, Dakota page edits. And then like, I will do 3 hour increments, because if I look at it for too long, then yeah, you just have to have like fresh eyes sometimes. And sometimes I just do full on like shooting days as far as content days, and other days I will just do completely edit days. So I kind of see my week, I plan out my week every Sunday, and I just kind of break down what is going to be best for what's happening. You know what I mean? I can and I'm super fortunate of like a flexible schedule, but yeah, it's definitely, I do block increments, if that makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it, so like, I know it's kind of embarrassing to say, but like for the longest, like I've kind of didn't take that approach, and like I always struggled with finding time to like do different things, because I would, not that I didn't structure my day, but I wasn't as meticulous as others would be, because you know, when you have a family and you have, you know, your personal life and work, I don't know, I would find myself spending more time doing one versus the other. And even more recently with the, you know, the podcast last year was pretty, this, I'm almost on year two creating a podcast, and I wasn't as consistent with pumping out episodes. Yeah. And, or, you know, once they're edited, cutting them, getting highlights and doing all the different things like that, that it kind of took a back seat with everything else that was going on. You know, like last year, you know, work started to pick up and it was less of a focus, but I think it became less of a focus because I made it less of a focus. Yeah. I made it less of a priority instead of trying to fit it in with everything else. So, you know, like sometimes like I'm guilty of like, I have some free time and like, I'll just be, you know, scrolling on my phone or whatever.
It's bad. Yeah.
As opposed to,
yeah,
like, okay, like I just spent half hour, you know, going through Instagram reels or TikTok or, yeah, whatever. And then now I'm like,
yeah,
I could have been choosing music, yeah, or doing
for
something,
sure,
you know?
Yeah. And that's something I, like, I'm by myself, like, you know what I mean? Working, like, I work from home and nobody's like when you're on your phone, you're so like into it that you actually like, you need almost like somebody to talk to you to be like, oh shoot, I'm on my phone right now, I need to like put it down. I'm by myself, so no one's like having that like, hey Dakota, get off your phone type of thing. So I actually, I time myself, like I put my self timer on,
okay,
and I do like 20 minutes on Instagram, and then I actually delete the app every single day.
Oh,
and
wow,
that's something that has really helped me, because it sounds awful, but now I will go on my phone and it's an instant reaction to go to Instagram. And I hate that. It's like, it's so embarrassing for me, because it's just like, I do social media content all the time. So it's just like, I am on Instagram, but I just had to delete the app and then I can create. And what I've been doing recently is I've been timing my reels. So I will give myself an hour. And what can I do to like re-edit a film to make a reel or something like that? And then I only have 30 minutes or an hour to create, and I can't go over that. And so then I could just keep on busting out content, because actually your viewers, for me at least, like I feel like only a certain amount, especially with the algorithm and stuff. If you spend 6 hours on a reel, like half your viewers or followers are going to see that. But like, if you just keep on busting out like good, challenging yourself and getting quicker and quicker at editing, now I can do like reels in 20 minutes, you know, like bust out a quick film. So I've been doing that a lot as well. Like, you know what I mean? Timing myself and almost making it like a little challenge for my, like nobody else is like challenging me, but it's just something for me to like get it out quick and get more consistent work out there. Because I feel like social media is a full-time job these days. You
it
know
is.
What I mean? It is, like literally. And to stay on, like to show up, you know what I mean? Because I believe that's part of your brand is showing up, showing your face on Instagram. Creating reels, I believe, definitely can like get yourself out there. But they're not paying gigs, you know? And so I always try to figure out, like, I don't want to spend all my time on like Instagram. Do you know what I mean? Because yeah, I can get clients off of there, don't get me wrong, and I love building my portfolio, but that's not bringing in like a paycheck, you know what
right.
I mean? As far as like really working on my edits and like reaching out to brands and like working with that. So it's definitely a balance, you know? And I feel like sometimes I don't show up on Instagram, and then I can kick myself, you know what I mean? Because like as a creative, we want to show up, but life happens. And I believe that you just have to have grace and just hop back in, because it's always moving. Do you know what I mean? It's not going to like slow down, but you also can just jump in whenever is best for you. But yeah, I definitely think blocking time, and you have 8 hours in a day, let's say, you know what I mean? Or whatever you want to give into that day, let's say 6 hours, 1 hour for yourself. You know what I mean? Like whether prepping, listening to your favorite playlist that gets you going, like, going on a walk, listening to a podcast, YouTube. I love education on YouTube. I do like an hour of just like kind of prepping, and then like 2 hours of just like this video, and then 2 hours of that video. Or I'm like on that roll of that video. I will stay on that video. You know what I mean? Cause I don't want to like stop the flow,
right.
But definitely blocking my time and putting in time for myself and just for my own energy, I think is 100% meaning, like, intentional and meaningful for your day. Like, it's worth it. Yeah.
And how, I mean, what are some of the, like, the inspirations of kind of like, how did you come to figuring that out for yourself?
Trial and error. A lot of trial and error.
Right.
And also just feeling like the burned out. Like, I would wake up and I would be in my sweatpants, and my husband would come home and he would make dinner, and I would go to bed in those sweatpants. Like, and that's not, like, don't get me wrong, I would bust some content out, but that didn't, like, fuel me. Like, I am a human being, and if I go down, my brand's going down. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
no, I hear you.
Yeah, so you have to take care of yourself, and I believe in that now, because health issues, but also just, like, getting worn out. Like, I it's crazy. I feel like a lot of, like, 20-year-olds, they should get burned out these days, because social media, there's so much to create, I feel like, and we all just want to, like, keep up with it, and I want to create. I want to be on social media. I want to produce films that I'm proud of. But, like, you actually have to put yourself first. And so for me, that was, like, a huge awakening moment. Is, like, to be my best version of myself, I actually have to put in time for myself. And it's not paying. Like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. it's weird for me to, like, spend 8 to 9 just for myself. When I'm like, I could be working right now.
Well,
but
you say
yeah.
It's not paying, but it kind of is, right?
Yes. Because yeah, it is, though. Yes. Yeah.
At the end of the day, you're kind of, that's going to help you down the road.
For sure. You like, when you're sick and you start editing, you're putting 40% in. You know what I mean? Like, get better and then put your 100% in. So for me, it has been a little bit of trial and error to figure out my schedule, but it's definitely something that I love, and I get excited because I don't feel burned out. And also the Instagram, like, I will delete Instagram and I will not be on after 6 o'clock. And then I don't have to feel obligated. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm off the clock, because as a, like, your own business, like, as a business owner, you are constantly thinking of your company. You're eating, yeah. You wake up, you
oh,
fall
I gotta
asleep.
Do this, I gotta do that.
Exactly. Oh, I make lists
follow
all
up.
The time. Yes, yeah, I make lists all the time. But at 6 o'clock, like, or you know what I mean? 7 o'clock, whatever you want to make your time at in the evening, like, I'm not gonna make my brand better. Do you know what I mean? By, like, putting in 2 more hours when I could be having that for my relationship or for myself, or you know what I mean? So I've definitely been selfish, I feel like. And I feel like that's such a negative connotation, selfish, but I think it's a necessity as a business owner.
Yeah, I feel like, I mean, even not only, like, in business, but just in life in general, you kind of have to dedicate that time to yourself, because otherwise, yeah, you don't, I don't know. Yeah, it's just literally just burns you out, whether yeah. it be, you know, with a relationship or, you know, your personal life, that it, yeah, if you're not prioritizing yourself, then, you know, how are you going to show up tomorrow?
Yeah, you know? Exactly. So I believe in it. And it's a lot of trial and error. And I believe, like, I do a week trials. So I will set, like I said, I plan my week out on every Sunday, and I will, like, kind of change something new. I will say, like, okay, I'm going to wake up at 5 o'clock every morning and see how that works. And if I, like, that following Sunday, I'm like, okay, that did not work for my schedule. And so I'm going to, like, rearrange it. And so that's what I mean by trial and error. I would, like, almost challenge myself every week to kind of figure out what was that routine, what was that rhythm that I kind of needed. Because I think rhythm is a better word, because routine is just, like, very strategical. But rhythm is almost like, okay, I was on a roll with this, and I can actually produce this film, like, tonight. You know what I mean? So then I'll keep going or whatever. But yeah, really, like, listening to your body and listening to, like, your creative mind, you know? It's like, sometimes I can't edit one day, you know? And I'm like, okay, I will work on inquiries. I will just work on social media and stuff. And so I believe in just, like, giving yourself grace, because it's, like, as a business owner, half of it is just the mindset and the, like, getting overcoming mindset over matter type of, yeah.
Yeah, are there, like, any books or podcasts that you kind of, that have kind of helped mold all of this?
Like I said, it's so funny. I reread Think Like a Monk all the time. I honestly, and I listen to Jay Shetty's podcast. It's called On Purpose.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love it. It's something, I just love how he just puts his mental health first. And that's something that I've been 100% making a 360 in my, like, life. And it's been very positive, which is so cool as far as, personally and on my business front. And it's cool because it's always scary kind of changing directions as a business owner. Because, like I said, I was just booking on clients, and I was like, I want to book all those clients in a way. You know, you see money and you're like, yeah, okay, cool.
Okay, let's
do it. Let's do it. Sure, for sure. And then the time comes 2 years later and you're shooting it and you're like, I can't even provide for myself, let alone, like, for my family, you know, and that's not cool. And so for me, having that, like, book really, like, shook my world. And so now I will literally, I have like three copies around my house, and I believe in, like, if I have it out, I will like pick up a book, like pick it up, and I'll like read it, and I always pull something else from it. Wow. So literally it is like it's a guide for my life right now. And until I like get sick of it, I will move on. But I also love Ryan Holiday. He has a trilogy, and it's just about like going over like your obstacle courses, like seeing the problem and facing it direct on. I mean, I know that sounds like very like cliche, but it's something that I struggle with. I always am trying to like get around it or like work a little bit harder when that's not actually the case that I need to be doing and stuff. Yeah. So it's been a...
Now we got trains.
Oh my goodness. Wow. we got the whole trans... Is it out there? Oh, yeah, I was like, what is happening?
It's literally
a train. I love it. I definitely believe in having... people who have that same mindset that you want to strive, it's kind of like the person in the back of your ear, and always just tapping into it. Like, I will pick up and I'll read a page, and if I get something out of it, I'll put it down. I'm like, okay, cool. I got something out of it that I needed at that moment. Sometimes I'll read an entire chapter and it, like, you know what I mean? So having that, like, almost that guidance of giving yourself grace, because like I said, as a creative, there's so much out there that you can do, and it's so exciting, and I'm excited to like do everything. But I feel like little bits of pieces, if I put myself first and I work hard and I make every film very intentional, then I'm going to get there, you know? Like little bites, you know? So that's something that I've really been working on as far as right now, and building my portfolio, building my relationships, building like my creative skill sets and stuff. So yeah, I feel like my word for 2022 actually for my company is like building. But yeah, what would you say your word is as far as like for yourself and your creative life?
For me right now, it's consistency.
Consistency,
and like it's
a good one.
I think that is something I've probably, I've openly talked about it, that like I've struggled with just being consistent. And like, it's not that I don't say that I don't show up or that I don't put as much effort as I can, but I know I could do a lot more, and I haven't been as intentional as I could be with a lot of things, you know, whether it's, you know, creating content for the podcast or booking guests or even some of the, like the creative work. There's been times in the last few months where I've kind of passed on jobs because I wasn't like all there.
Yeah.
You know, and really just, I think kind of getting back into like a routine or like, you know, like you said, a rhythm has really helped me in like, okay, you know, these are the things that I want to accomplish. And if I am not consistent, I'm not going to be able to accomplish that.
It's a lot of discipline.
Yeah.
Because no one's coming for you. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, my dad actually told me this, and it's like it's a very harsh approach almost. But like, he was like, nobody's coming for you. Like, you got to show up. And if you do love what you do, and like you have a direction that you want to go in your company, you got to work for it every single day. And that's something that I'm a very hungry person. I want something like now. I know that sounds very like, but you know what I mean? Like, I'm just like, okay, I want this, and yeah, I'm going to work really hard for it. But that's not the case. Like, you need to like work at it a little bit at a time. And for me, making like lists and like doing like a little bit, like I said, like a 30-minute reel or like an edit or whatever. And just like getting those out the door. Cause then I am showing up for my company. I am having that consistency or whatever, but yeah.
It's really been a lot of like structuring my time around with not only with what I consume, but, you know, just I don't want to say forcing myself to do things, but I've been a lot more intentional now of like, okay, if this is, you know, if I want to, you know, grow the podcast, I want to keep making episodes, that I need to book guests, and I need to like actually edit them and actually put them out. So I've been, you know, focused on, you know, getting people recording the episodes, figuring out, okay, now I have time, I'm blocking out this time to edit it, cut out whatever social media pieces. And it's been exciting, because like I feel like for the longest time I'm finally kind of catching into a rhythm, into like this flow of like, okay, you know, I'm starting to knock things out, and like I'm even starting to like revisit some things that I've kind of been sitting on, you know, like last year. And like even before COVID, like whenever COVID first happened, you know, like I was involved with a lot of like different things, because when nobody was working, we're doing all these different things, and I kind of just stopped focusing on it and didn't do anything. So like even now I'm kind of revisiting like these old edits that I kind of started putting together, and, you know, trying to make something of it. But you know, another good friend of mine and person that I had on the list, kind of going to the consistency piece, Ross, he talks about how, you know, I've always admired how he's like, oh, you know, your Instagram captions are very, you know, they're very deep and you have a lot to say and, you know, you're able to kind of be consistent. Like, yeah, well, it's not like I sit every day at 5 a.m. and do it. It's like, no, like what I do is literally if I'm, you know, sitting at home doing nothing or I'm in the shower or whatever and I get an idea about something that could potentially be used for like content, he's very intentional of like, okay, I'm gonna jot it down or write exactly my thoughts at this moment and then I'll revisit it whenever I feel it's relevant. So
for sure,
you know, he talks about like he like creates this like batch or like this backlog of like potential content or ideas that he's like he can revisit whenever he feels it's relevant. So he's like, yeah, a lot of times these captions, I'm not typing them up when I'm posting it. I'm like, I have something that I've typed like, you know, weeks ago because I had this idea or this feeling and, you know, I'll just elaborate and, you know, touch it up or whatever. And then now it becomes this piece. So, you know, I've always approached it of like, okay, well, I'm going to post this now. Well, I need to come up with like an idea and applying some of that with, you know, with things that I want to do, or even if like if I get ideas for something, has allowed me now to kind of like I've started kind of build like this like library of,
I love that,
of like these different concepts, ideas for videos or things that I want to do with the podcast or even with like work wise that I'm able to kind of now when I get those like bits of inspiration or free time that instead of
you
like
dive in now. Yeah.
So like I literally started, I have like these like little, like this document with like all these like different ideas. And like, whenever I go in, like I'll flesh out a little bit more type or, you know, whatever. And it's allowed me to kind of like, oh, now this is like actually start, like, I'm starting to like see it.
I love that.
And be like, oh, this is actually turning into something now that like so I can actually now revisit. And, you know, there's a few of them like, okay, well now I pretty much have this whole script outlined. So now I just gotta actually go out and shoot. I don't have to like think about what I'm gonna write or what I'm gonna talk about. So
that's so funny that he kind of like my notes app is hysterical. I have so much like ideas because they come randomly and you have to write them down or else like they go somewhere. I don't know where. But for me, I was going like just kind of cleaning out like my notes in a way, and I just found all of these like shot ideas and the songs that like inspired me for. I literally like create like I had an entire library of inspiration that I never got to do like over the years. And so now actually kind of going back to like doing creative stuff, I gave myself one creative like short film every month of this year.
Okay.
So like I'm going to be doing like, and whether it's like a 3-minute video or just like a minute like edit or whatever, like something that feels for me that I've thought of down the road or whatever. So I'm actually really excited. My first one's going to be this weekend. And it was like something I like jotted down like over the years, which is so cool. And so for me, I believe in like creating that library, writing it down, because the sparks of creativity, they come randomly when like throughout the day.
If you didn't write it down.
Yeah, you have to write it down.
Have fun remembering.
Yes. Yeah, no, exactly. So it's been really exciting for me to like, and that's when I believe like batch work also. I don't know if you do like a lot of batch work, but I run 4 social media jobs, and I used to work for a marketing company, and I think I did like 10 social media jobs. Like,
oh, wow.
It was a lot. But what we always did was like we batched so much work. So we did like the month of February was ready by the end of January. You know what I mean? Like almost like your collection. Like, you know how like clothes, they always have like, they're always ahead of like the season or whatever. That's how we could always stay consistency on those platforms. So I've definitely tried to incorporate that as far as like my own personal brand and stuff. But it definitely is like difficult though, because I want like it's more difficult to sit down and post every single day of like from blank. Do you know what I mean? But if you have it already batched up, you already have content, you have little reels that you want to share and stuff, you have inspirational quotes, you have captions and stuff, and then you just literally fill in the blank. And a really good app for that is Planoly, if you need one. It's okay. Great. Yeah, it's really great. Little aside. Cool. Yeah. But it really helps though, as far as consistency though, because I don't want to feel like, or sometimes I'm burnt out, or I've been editing all day, like, I don't know. I feel like I don't even have anything to post. Like, it's not done yet, you know? So, like, I can, like, go back to edits. I can re-edit, and I can, like, just create, like, a whole feed of grid. And then you just do automatically posting, which is really nice. So I don't have to even be on Instagram. But I'm still showing up, and it's still consistent as far as my feed.
Okay.
So, yeah, definitely recommend that as far as for consistency.
Yeah, that's good, because I feel like even, you know, that not only – so, like, I've taken that approach with you know, with like creating, right? And like, you know, I want to be present, social media, et cetera, all that stuff. But even in my personal life, like I feel like it's given me a little bit more peace of mind being able to find different outlets and kind of dedicate time to do things that I enjoy doing, mm-hmm. as you know, that way I can spend more time with family. I can do, you know, be more intentional with like how I use my time. Cause I feel like for the longest, like it's just, yeah, just kind of been all over the place and not really like prioritizing anything. Like, I don't know. It sounds weird just saying it out loud that like, yeah, you kind of like structure your day or like kind of live by like a schedule, but it's even if it's like loosely, like you kind of have to have some structure because otherwise you don't get shit done.
Yeah. Cause like, I don't work a 9-to-5 or like I kind of do in a way, but like, it's not like I clock in and like clock out. I'm very fortunate that I can create my own schedule. But for me, I wanted to have time for my relationship. I wanted to have time for myself. I wanted to have time for building my brand. And so and editing, like, do you know what I mean? Doing my actual job.
Right.
And so for me, doing that like batch work, like literally setting a timer, and I will like literally do on my alarms, and I'll be like, okay, now work on this. Now work on this. So then I have 2 hours to completely give my entire focus on that. And then I feel really, really productive because I've really done intentional time. Because I feel like for a while I would work like 8 hours, but it was like a little bit here. I would get an Instagram DM. I would message them back. I would go on my inquiry. I would like, I would just be everywhere and not at one spot. And actually you need to kind of, or for me at least, I needed to be focused on one spot and then I could do the next thing. So like for me, do all of my inquiries, all my DMs, all my messaging in the morning and then go right to like editing. And so I'd like, and then if I need to touch back on like my emails the end of the day, but like not like going back and forth, because I feel like that's when it gets messy and it gets, your brain can't handle it all, you know, like you literally flip a switch. Lack of coffee. No, but so that's definitely helped me as far as like blocking out time frames to have undivided attention. Is that correct? Right?
Yeah.
Undivided attention.
Give yourself grace.
Yeah. Give yourself grace.
No, it's funny because like I think that, I mean, that really what, you know, all doing all of that really is what allows you to kind of give yourself grace to, that way you don't feel overwhelmed or, you know, burdened with like, oh, I need to get all these things done, you know, at once. And like, I don't know, because I feel like that's kind of what happens sometimes, right? You kind of just, do everything right here and right now. So I guess with that being said, how do you see, you know, obviously you want to, you know, continue doing the weddings, but like, what do you see yourself kind of getting yourself into, you know, in the incoming future, like moving forward, like how do you see yourself, you know, next page or the whole Dakota brand itself? Like what do you want to do with it?
Oh, it's such a scary question in a way, because like, I don't even open up my books. You know what I mean? For like 2020, like I've booked a couple 2023, but it's always just so scary. Like what is going to be next year? What is going to be the end of the year? I don't even know who that version of Dakota is going to be. Hopefully she's better than today, you know?
Right.
So, that's kind of like the vision of next page, is it's always going to be evolving. And so as far as kind of what that is going to look like, I definitely always want to be in the filmmaking, but I've been actually doing a lot of hybrid this year as far as doing photography and filmmaking.
Okay.
And especially with my elopements, I'm allowed to do all the content during the day. And my husband actually does the officiating. And so literally
I didn't realize. So you guys are kind of like,
we make like a package deal essentially.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. So, and I didn't realize that. So like, even when you're traveling for these films, you're with your husband.
Yes. And he helps second shoot with me. I trained him well. No, but it is really nice though, because for elopements, it's so intimate that sometimes it's literally just the bride and groom, or it's like their family, like a couple family members. But for the most part, it's a very intimate group and I don't really know them, you know? So, and let alone like, they don't really want to have a crew of 5 or 6,
right.
You know? Like a wedding planner, 2 videographers, 2 photographers. It's a lot. And so for me, I really want to be that like kind of one-stop shop essentially. Like I really want next page to a couple bookings this year, I'm actually like part of a planning process. Like I have like a planning fee actually. And then I'm doing the photography and the videography. And I am actually like capable to do that because it is so intimate that like, I can literally like kind of restage, or we just don't have like a time frame, like a wedding. Do you know what I mean? Like at 5 o'clock, that's a ceremony. And then we have family photos. Like that's not really the case. So for me, I've been wanting definitely to do the one-stop shop, that like everything is
through next page, and even their wedding officiant. My husband, he's he got his license to officiate weddings, and so he does that. So they can literally book everything. And so I think that's what I really want Next Page to be, is like a one-stop shop. But I also am coming out with like a wearable collection. I am starting a coffee shop here in the near future. I literally am going to throw so much under Next Page. I'm so excited. So pretty much your answer is, I have no idea where Next Page is going, and it is so exciting. It's a next chapter. Do you know what I mean? That's what I really wanted to play on. Next Page. Yeah, exactly. Kind of full circle there. But I never wanted it to be like a niche or a narrow thing, because I've been a type of person that has her foot in everything. And if I want to do something, I will run into it. Like, I will go full force into it. I'm really excited about where Next Page is going. I'm actually currently rebranding, and so that's coming out this spring, and I'm so freaking excited about it. But I definitely want to do like styled shoots and stuff like that. That's something I'm very passionate about, as far as like the planning portion as well, and creating just something beautiful and epic and like really emotional. That's something I definitely want to do. So I have a couple of different things that are going on, and it's just, I'm always busy. I never want to slow down ever, which is a good thing and a bad thing. But yeah, it's an exciting time for Next Page.
So as we start to wrap up, you know, is there anything that you would like to share, or any questions that you may have, you know, just to kind of, I guess, put a ribbon on all of this? Cause I think it's, you know, like I told you earlier, I'm grateful that we were able to make this happen. And we've been talking about it for quite some time. And, you know, I'm very appreciative of you being able to kind of, I know with everything that you have going on, you know, you're pretty busy that you're here, and I've enjoyed this conversation.
It's been so much fun. No, I love like verbally like vomiting. I know that sounds so bad, but like as a creative it's a good conversation to have, and just to like know that somebody's out there and they're going through the same thing too. It's always like really reassuring and stuff. But as far as kind of like wrapping it up, I guess just for all of the people out there that like they're just hungry for more, like take small bites and like prioritize the things that you want in your life. Like for me, I grew up in Ohio, and I idolized people who were on a different like place than me in a way in life. And I really was very defeated that I haven't been there yet. But I'm going through my own journey, and it is so exciting. And I just want to like give everybody out there like a little bit sense of like grace in a way that like your journey is perfectly the way that it's supposed to be right now, and that like you will get to where you want if you do prioritize your time and your commitment and the consistency. If you build those little habits, it's going to fall into place. It's bound to happen, you know, and it's going to be better than you ever imagined. And for me, I that's just something that I wish someone told me in a way, because I just feel like I've given a lot of energy to feeling more defeated than kind of like going forward. I've always kind of like, or I used to take a step back and not really take a step forward. And I just recommend just like finding things that inspire you, that lift you up, that not compares, but inspire, motivates and inspires you. So I don't know if that makes sense, but for me, that's just something I've really worked on, you know. And now my company, the direction it is so exciting. It's something I've wanted for many, many years. And the journey that it's become is something I don't want to give trade for anything. And I think having that understanding and that grace, I really wish I had earlier, but I get that's part of the journey. But of just really like working really hard for what you want, but kind of like falling in love with the process and just giving yourself grace is, I guess, what I want to say.
I'm sure grace is going to be in the title of the podcast.
I think so too. Yeah.
I love the message, because there's so much truth to it. And like, even, you know, what you just said about, you know, being able to kind of just take the step forward, take small bites. Cause you know, personally, I feel like I've kind of been stuck for a little bit and like, it's, yeah, I mean, that's literally what it takes, is just actually just start moving forward.
Yeah. And like another thing too, this is kind of going back into like our scheduling and kind of like how I organize it, but I used to make like a list of like 14 things to do for my day, and I would feel so defeated when I didn't get those done. And so for now, like nowadays, I make a list of 5 things. buy things that I can get done or like I can work forward or something. And then when I cross those off, it's a very productive day.
Yes, exactly.
Because as a creative, like you can work on a project for 40 plus hours. Like seriously, there's some projects that are like that for me. Yep. And so it's, you just don't feel very productive, but like I make like a list that is doable. And yeah, so anyways, little bites like that and just giving yourself grace, because after you create those habits and you put in that little bit of time, you're putting yourself first, you're learning, you're absorbing, you're asking for help, you're like connecting with people, all of a sudden you look back and you're where you've wanted to be all along. And it's pretty cool, at least for me. I've had that realization that like I want to appreciate that I've worked hard for this, and this is something I really, really wanted, like 15-year-old Coda in high school. This is what she wanted, and I just want to appreciate where I'm at and also keep going, because there's so much I'm going to, like, tackle in the future, and, yeah, just having grace.
It was very beautifully said. And with that, where can our listeners find you on social media? Where would you like to point them and
so wrap it up? Yeah, I'm currently rebranding right now, so my website is under construction, which is so sad. But okay. The best form to find me is on Instagram, and it's next.page, and page is P-A-I-G-E, so N-E-X-T dot P-A-I-G-E.
Awesome. With that being said, Dakota, thank you for coming on the podcast. It was wonderful talking to you, and wish you very much continued success with everything that you're doing, and talk to you soon.
Well, ditto. Thank you so much.
All right. Take care, everybody.